وأصلي وأسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. ما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، كل محدثة بدعة، كل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. And this night, inshallah, we'll talk about two names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Al-Qarib and Al-Mujib. Al-Qarib and Al-Mujib. What is the meaning of the name Al-Qarib and the name Al-Mujib? The name Al-Qarib means the near, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is Qarib. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Qarib. And Al-Mujib means the one, or the answerer, or the one who responds, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Qarib, Al-Mujib. In the Quran, the name Al-Qarib mentioned three times. The name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Qarib, mentioned three times in the famous ayah, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيب. This is very clear. فَإِنِّي قَرِيب. Okay, maybe this ayah tells you a qarib as a description, maybe not a name, but the other ayah makes it clear that it is a name. In Surah Hud, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the stories of some of the prophets, alayhim as-salatu was-salam. فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ ثُمَّ تُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ إِنَّ رَبِّي قَرِيبٌ مُجِيبٌ. So this is an ayah for both names. Qarib, near, Mujib, response, the answer. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, the call. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Qaribun, Mujib. Another ayah. Surah Saba, قُلْ إِنْ ضَلَلْتُ فَإِنَّمَا أَضِلُّ عَلَى نَفْسِي وَإِنْ اهْتَدَيْتُ فَبِمَا يُوحِي إِلَيَّ رَبِّي إِنَّهُ سَمِيعٌ قريب. سبحانه وتعالى. In hadith, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in صحيح مسلم and also صحيح البخاري, he was with the companions أبو موسى الأشعري رضي الله تعالى عنه, عبد الله بن قيس أبو موسى الأشعري. He said, we were with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in غزوة خيبر, the 17th, the place of Yahud, the Jews. When we went through أشرفنا على وادي, we were near to reach a valley, we were raising our voice. Some of the companions raised their voice in dhikr Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by saying, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah. So they were walking and making dhikr, not singing, not joking, chat, dhikr. This is ghazwa, this is a battle of Khaybar. This is the time of the companions, radiyallahu ta'ala anhum. Dhikrullahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wala dhikrullahi akbar. The remembrance of Allah is greater. Greater than what? In the language, okay, what they teach us? Arabic or English language. Greater than, and you mention something, صح? Okay. Haji Rafiq is older than me. Older, you should mention both. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا ذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرُ. Greater. Greater than what? Than everything. It is not mentioned in the ayah, but it is known. وَلَذِكْرُ اللَّهِ, the remembrance of Allah is greater. We say in the salah, in the adhan, as a dhikr, Allahu Akbar. That's it. Allah is greater. Maybe as a translation, sometimes we see Allah is the greatest. If you want the correct translation, it is Allah is greater, akbar, because greatest means al akbar, But here greater. Greater than what? Than everything. Allah is greater than your job, your wife, your family, your business, your food, anything. Allah is greater than everything, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they were walking with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with takbir, with tahleel. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah. Raising their voice. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Arbi'u ala anfusikum. Which means that when we are traveling, it is not only 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, 1 day, 2 days, maybe 5 days, 6 days. So imagine if you are most of the time saying takbir, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, la ilaha. What will happen? You'll get tired. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, make it easy for yourself. Make it easy for yourself. Arbi'a ala anfusikum. Don't harm yourself by, why? Because this will swell your throat or you will be tired. Why? Innakum la tad'una asamma wa la ghaiba. You are not calling a deaf and you are not calling an absent, which means he can hear you and he is present, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he said, إِنَّكُمْ تَدْعُونَ سَمِيعًا قَرِيبًا. You are calling a hearer, subhanahu wa ta'ala, قَرِيبًا, near. What is the point you raise your voice? He can hear you. He can hear you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he is with you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which means he can hear you, he can protect you, he can reward you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abu Musa, the one who narrated the hadith, he was behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam riding a dabba, maybe a camel or a donkey, whatever. And he was saying dhikr alone, not raising his voice. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. And he was repeating la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam noticed him. He was not raising his voice, but he noticed. He heard him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, أَلَا أَدُلُّكَ عَلَىٰ كَنْزٍ مِّن كُنُوزِ الْجَنَّةِ. Do you like that? I tell you about a treasure from paradise? For sure, yes, O Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, لَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. لا حول ولا قوة. Okay, already the Prophet, already Abdullah ibn Qais, Abu Musa al-Sha'i was saying this dhikr. What is the point the Prophet ﷺ told him? It is like a glad tiding for him. Which means keep saying this dhikr, it is from paradise, a treasure from paradise. Another narration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَالَّذِي تَدْعُونَهُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَىٰ أَحَدِكُمْ مِنْ عُنُقِ رَاحِلَةِ أَحَدِكُمْ. The one you are calling, he's nearer to you than the neck of your camel. What is the distance between you and the neck of your camel or your horse? Maybe one hand span. Allah is nearer than that, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He hears you, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he answers you. Okay, the same hadith, there is another narration, but not in Bukhari or Muslim. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّكُمْ تَدْعُونَ قَرِيبًا مُجِيبًا. You are calling a near and an answerer, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in this narration, Musnad Ahmad, he mentioned both of these names. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Ibrahim, he traveled. You know, he was in his country, he traveled to Egypt, he traveled to several places. Alayhi salatu wa sallam, Makkah. So he went to a place in the hadith not mentioned. But when he entered that city, there was a tyrant king. And he used to take the women in haram way. And subhanAllah, the wife of Ibrahim Sarah was beautiful, so beautiful. So he heard that, or people told him, his soldiers, the deviant, the devils told him, there is a very beautiful woman with a man. So Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam said, listen, or يعني, he called Ibrahim, who's that woman with you? He said, this is my sister, إنها أختي. Then he told him, when you go home, send your sister to us. أعوذ بالله حرام. But what to do? He's alone with his wife, Sarah. So he went home and he told his, or his camp, to his camel, يعني he doesn't have home in this city. He said, you know that there is no believer on the earth except me and you. Can you imagine? No believers at all except me and you. And I mentioned that you are my sister. فَلَا تُكَذِّبِينِي. Please, don't show him that I am a liar. Why? Because the scholars say, because he will, if he knows that this is husband, he immediately will kill him. But if he is a brother, he will leave him. And he will take the woman. So he's taking the woman. You are a husband, you are a brother, he's taking the woman. But what is the difference? If you tell I am brother, he will leave you. If you tell I am a husband, he will kill you. So I told him that you are my sister. So when she went there, they took her there. And she entered. And he wanted for haram. Then he invoked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Oh Allah, you know that I am a believer. And I am a clean woman, a pure woman. My farj only for my husband. My private part only my husband for the halal, which means for the halal. Protect me. فَغُطَّ حَتَّى صَارَ تَضْرِبْ رِجُوهُ فِي الْأَرْضِ. غُطَّ وَزِمْ غُطَّ يعني he could not breathe. And subhanAllah, when the one who cannot breathe, he will move his legs too fast. Then he was asking her, please release me, this king, this tyrant king. Then again, he tried to attack and to do the haram with her. Then and she invoked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again. And again, he was in a big trouble, this tyrant king. Again, he could not breathe. And he asked her to help, subhanAllah. Okay, why she was asking, why she asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to release him from this suffocation? Because she said, Allah, oh Allah, إن يموت يتهموني أني قتلته. Oh Allah, if he dies now, they will accuse me that I killed him. So oh Allah, please release him from this problem. Another narration, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, فقامت توضأ تصلي. She did wudu and she started to pray. In this difficult situation, subhanAllah. So after two or three times, this tyrant king said, take her from here. She's not a woman, she's shaitan. Astaghfirullah. He is shaitan, not she's shaitan. He said to his soldiers, take him, take her outside. She's shaitan. What you brought to me? وَأَخْدَمَهَا هَاجَر. And he gifted her Hajar. When she went to Ibrahim, what he was doing? He was doing salah. He was praying dua. SubhanAllah. She was making dua and he was making dua. And Allah al-Mujib, he answered them. أَمَّا يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَى. She was in distress. And she invoked Allah, and Allah answered. And the same thing, Ibrahim. You know, this is one of the main points, brothers and sisters, to prove when you read about how to prove the existence of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. They say, this is called دليل الحس. How to prove the existence of Allah؟ دليل الفطرة، دليل الدين، دليل العقل، دليل الحس. What are the types of proofs, the evidences to prove the existence of Allah؟ They mention number one, العقل. Logical things tell you that Allah is there, the existence of Allah. دليل الفطرة, the nature. Number three, الشرع. When you read the book of Allah, you'll come to know the existence of Allah for sure, many ayat. Number four, دليل الحس, the sense, that the things that we can see. Like this story, Ibrahim. He invoked Allah, Allah answered. She invoked Allah, Allah answered. He's the mujib. He's qareeb. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you come through the seerah, you'll find many places, the Quran and the sunnah. The name, Al-Mujib. Ayyub was sick for how many years? 18 years. وَأَيُّوبَ إِذْ نَادَ رَبَّهُ رَبَّ أَنِّي مَسَّنِيَ الضُّرُّ وَأَنْتَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ. When Ayyub called upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, okay, oh Allah, the harm touched me. The harm touched me. And you are the most merciful, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Immediately, فَاسْتَجَبْنَا, we answered him. After him, وَذَنُّونَ, Yunus. وَذَنُّونَ إِذْ ذَهَبَ مُغَاضِبًا فَظَنَّ أَلَّا نَقْدِرَ عَلَيْهِ فَنَادَى فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ. He called upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he was inside the stomach of the whale. La ilaha illa ant. Subhanaka inni kuntu. Fastajabna. Immediately we answered him. Zakariya, old man. When he became old, too old. His wife too old. Barren. Wa Zakariya nada rabbahu rabbi la tadirni fardan. Oh Allah, don't leave me alone. Wa anta khayrul warithin. You are the best of the inheritors. Fastajabna lah. Wahabna lahu Yahya. We answered him and we bestowed him Yahya. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Ghazwat Badr, in the battle of Badr, 1/3 of Quraysh not prepared for fighting. The whole night he was calling upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, anta ahlik hadhihi al-asaba lan tu'batu al-ard, oh Allah, oh Allah, oh Allah. He was raising his hand like this. His clock fell down. Abu Bakr came and he put it again. He said, oh Rasulullah, it is enough. It is enough. Why? There is a trust. Abu Bakr has the trust that Allah will answer you. This is the name, Al-Mujib, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The answerer, subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need that. Ud'u Allah wa antum muqinuna bil-ijaba. Call upon Allah while you are sure in the answer. Al-Khattabi rahimahullah ta'ala said about the name Al-Qarib. He is near in his knowledge to his creation. And he is near to the one who is calling him to answer him. Al-Zajjaji said, Qarib means the one who is not far. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Tabari, he said about the ayah, Qareebul Mujib, subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said it means that my Lord is near to the one who is sincere in his worship. And he is answering those who are calling him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we see these two names, Al-Qareebul Mujib, طيب, Allah, which means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears those who are calling him. And he is answering them. And this doesn't contradict that he is above his throne and he is near. This name says he is near. And the other ayat says Allah is above the throne. How? We should not say how. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. Nothing is like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is for us. Okay, if I say, wallahi, I am in America and I am near. How? You are in America and you are near. But for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِي شَيْءٍ. Nothing is like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he is near why he is above the throne. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we come to the name Al-Qarib, he is near Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number one, he is near to all of his creation. Even the kuffar, the disbelievers. What does that mean? He is near from, he knows what they are doing, what they are saying. So they say this is Al-Qurb Al-Am. He is near, generally he is near to them, to his creation. Muslim, kafir, jinn, ins, everyone. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we say this kind of nearness, it doesn't mean this is a virtue for him. Tayyib, where is the virtue? The other one. The other one. He is near to his believers. Which means now the support. So there is a general qurb, near, and there is a specific. So he is near to his believers. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, which means he is supporting them. طيب. When we come to the name Al-Mujib, the answerer, the one who responds, this is for both the Muslim and Kafir. But no doubt it is stronger for the Muslim, but it can be for the Kafir. How? When you read Surah Al-An'am, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قل, this is to the Kuffar, قل من ينجيكم من ظلمات البحر من ظلمات البر والبحر تدعونه تضرعا وخفيا لئن أنجان من هذه لنكونن من الشاكرين قل الله ينجيكم. O Muhammad, say to them, who saves you when you are in the darkness in the desert or the sea, calling upon him تضرعا وخفيا, with submission, with humbleness. If you save us, we will be thankful. Allah said to the Prophet ﷺ, say to them, Allah saves you from that and from any distress. But where is the problem? Then you are doing shirk. So this ayah means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers the call of the kuffar when they are in the distress, when they are in the trouble, in the disaster. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he said to Mu'ad radiyallahu ta'ala, وَاتَّقِ دَعْوَةَ الْمَظْلُومِ فَإِنَّهُ لَيْسَ بَيْنَهُ بَيْنَ اللَّهِ حِجَابٌ. And be aware, be careful, avoid the dua of the oppressed, because there is nothing in between the dua of the oppressed and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The scholars say here, this hadith general for the Muslim and for the kafir. Because the Prophet ﷺ sent Mu'ad to Yemen, and it was a non-Muslim country, Christian country. And this is very important. It doesn't mean that your maid or your driver or your employees kuffar. It means I don't give them their rights. No, you should be careful. Zulm haram always. Oppression is haram always. With Muslim, with non-Muslim, with a friend, with anyone, haram. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mujib even with the kuffar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about Iblis. Who's Iblis? The worst. No one is worse than Iblis. قَالَ, he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He invoked Allah. قَالَ رَبِّي فَأَنظِرْنِي إِلَى يَوْمِ يُبْعَثُونَ. Oh Allah, give me the chance to the day of judgment, to the day of resurrection, which means let me live this life until the day of judgment. This is dua. قَالَ رَبِّي, oh Allah, oh my Lord. He invoked Allah. And what do you notice here? Iblis invoked Allah with a name of Allah. قَالَ رَبِّي. He did not ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a name of an idol or a grave. He asked Allah. This is Iblis. While you find now some Muslims or many Muslims, they use other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in their dua. Ya Abdul Qadir, ya Jilani, ya أحمد يا حسين يا سبحان الله. إبليس is calling upon Allah يا ربي. And you find some Muslims calling other than Allah. Of course we will not say they are worse than Iblis. But in this point, Iblis is correct in calling Allah, of course. Of course not in his dua. But by saying يا رب. He knows that. But he's in the hellfire, no doubt. قال ربي فأنظرني إلى يوم يبعثون. Allah said, قال فإنك من المنظرين إلى يوم الوقت المعلوم. You are giving the chance to the specified date. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered him. Allah answered him. Why? Because he is al-mujib. So this means, brother, sister, the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-mujib, for both the Muslim and kafir. For both Muslim and kafir. But no doubt, the Muslim, his dua is stronger than the kafir. Because there are conditions for the dua. And no doubt, the Muslims fulfill more than what the kafir fulfills. He doesn't have faith, he doesn't. But Allah will answer him if he is in distress. He's musibah, in a trial. Another point when we come to the name Al-Mujib. So does he answer every dua? Yes and no. How yes and no? Yes, if there are the conditions according to the way of the way mentioned by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And no, if there is something invalidate the dua. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yes, answers every dua. But if there are the conditions. And also in the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. What do I mean by the way of the mention? That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned the dua can be answered in several ways. To give what you ask for. Oh Allah, I ask you for a job this month. Oh Allah, grant me a good job this month. You call upon Allah. So number one, Allah may answer you and grant you a job in this month. Or to delay the answer. Allah will not grant you the job this month, maybe after 3 months. Allahu a'lam, maybe it is khair. Allahu a'lam. Maybe you are thinking, you are planning for a job. And you are asking Allah, oh Allah, make it easy to accept my paper. Oh Allah, make it easy the interview. You ask Allah, you ask Allah, you ask Allah. Then they don't call you for the interview, or they tell you failed the interview. You feel very bad. Or they don't answer you. Why? Because Allah knows that the position in this company now, for a salary, for example, 500. But because of the delay, they call you after 2 months because there is a better position for 600. So Allah answered you, but not now, later. Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not answer you what you asked for. Allah will keep this dua for you at the day of judgment as hasanat, as a reward. So the day of judgment, you like that. You did not get that in dunya, because you are very happy when you see your hasanat in the akhirah. I made a lot of dua, but I got the answer in dunya, but nothing for me in the akhirah. I mean no hasanat, but imagine if my dua not answered dunya, but at the day of judgment when I come, I see my book is full of hasanat reward. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shifted my dua to hasanat. You know, sometimes you go to a place, they give you points. Yalla, you have points. Okay, what do you like your points? Miles for travel, or in a hotel, or cash back, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us as hasanat. The third one, Allah will save you from a harm. يَرُدْ عَلْكَ مِنَ السُّؤْ مِثْلَهِ. Because of your dua, 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 dua. Okay. Where is the answer? I'm making dua for 3 months. Until now, I'm jobless. Until now, no wife, no marriage, no car, no house. Okay? صح. You are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a wife? No wife. You are asking for a job? No job. You are asking for a bicycle? No bicycle. Whatever. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is protecting you from a car accident, from corona, from a thief, from a murder. Allah is protecting you a lot. From an insect, from a snake, from a magic. This is dua of this is the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And يعني والله it is very important when we read the Quran, we go through, we focus on the examples of the name of Allah al-Mujib. Yusuf alayhi salam, he was in a big trouble. Between what? Between women and jail. قال ربي السجن أحب إلي مما يدعونني إلي وإلا تصرف عني كيدهن أصب إليهن وأكن من الجاهل فاستجاب له ربه فصرف عنه كيدهن إنه هو السميع العليم. Imagine, he reached to a point, he preferred the jail. He preferred the jail, the prison. Why? Because the problem of women or the trial of women, مشكلة. The haram, of course, we mean the haram. The wife of the king or the wife of the minister and her friends, everyone is trying to do the haram with Yusuf. A'udhu billah. So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam was in a big trouble. And he feared that with time he may go with them. This is Yusuf alayhi salam. What about us? No, I'm a strong man. I don't care. You should care. You should care. Allah, this is a problem, you know. You know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the shaitan. Shaitan, are you stronger than shaitan? Inshallah, you are stronger than shaitan. Shaitan says, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إذا خرج المرأة عورة. إذا خرجت استشرف الشيطان. مرأة عورة. The woman is عورة. Yeah, subhanAllah, even with the full hijab, niqab, from top to bottom. عباية, نقاب, خمار, covered. Even if you cannot recognize the eyes, fitna. سبحان الله. إذا خرجت, when she is out the house, when she gets out the house, استشرفها الشيطان. What is the meaning of استشرف الشيطان? استشرفها means that if you want to see something far, you are in the desert, for example, and it is sun, dhuhr, noon time. You want to see something far. How to focus? Like this, huh? This is the meaning of استشرفها. So if there is a woman out the house, the shaitan will look like this. Ah, this is good chance for the shaitan. This is good chance for the shaitan. لِيُغْوِيهَا وَيُغْوِي بِهَا. To trap the woman in sin and also to use the woman to trap the men. Yalla, she's outside the house. Yalla. Before getting out the house, some makeup, nice shoes, perfume, walking in a way, even the walk, okay, your dress is, mashallah, nice, according to Sharia, your dress, your abaya, but the way of your talking and walking, shouting, okay, laughing in a loud voice, when she walks in a way, this is fitna. Many times I speak about this because it is, we notice this more and more. You find the woman with niqab and doing the exercise outside. Why? Lifting weight and bicycle, horse and everything. Why? Because I'm with hijab, so I can't do anything. No, this is wrong. You should not do anything like men. Subhanallah, yani, that's called even the walk. She should not walk like a man. She should not walk like a man. Why? Because it is haram to imitate the man. And haram for the woman to imitate the man. Wallah, I feel sorry when we notice some sisters with full hijab, I mean, covered, but she's not following the sharia. I am with hijab, khalas. I can go to any restaurant, any coffee, I do exercise, I do... No, this is wrong. This is wrong. What is the point that you speak in the public? Shkila. Because with time, she will change, usually, not always, will change. She's covered with niqab, but because for the screen, I should put some eyeliner. And with time, the first time the niqab like this. After 1 year, the niqab like this. Then, no niqab. Why? Because many scholars said the niqab is not wajib. MashaAllah. Just you know this opinion? Or did you know this opinion? And you were teaching this opinion and you were saying this is the wrong opinion. Now it became a correct opinion. This is fitna. So what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إذا خرجت المرأة استشرفها الشيطان. شيطان. Subhanallah. So back to, yes, I was talking about Yusuf alayhi salat wa salam. So he invoked Allah. And Allah answered him. Subhanallah. He asked, يعني, maybe someone said, okay, Yusuf asked Allah subhanahu to be in the prison, to be in jail, this is something bad. Okay. For sure, to be in the jail, this is something wrong, something bad. But when you compare that with the fitna that he was living in, for sure, to be in the jail, better. Subhanallah. If you come to Talut and Jalut, the story of Talut and Jalut. Talut, you know, his enemy Jalut, the tyrant king, very tough and strong. And his army became less and less. You know, I think we mentioned the story in two Jum'ah Khutbah. The story of Talut and Jalut with Dawood. Dawood was with them, alayhi salam, but he was young. He started with a very big army, but one test, another test, his army shrank. Why? Because they failed the test. And their number was like the companions of Badr. About 319. At the end they invoked Allah and Allah answered them al-mujib. Okay? وَلَمَّا بَرَزُوا لِجَالُوتَ وَجُنُودِهِ قَالُوا رَبَّنَا أَفْرِغْ عَلَيْنَا صَبْرًا. Oh Allah, pour patience in our hearts. وَثَبِّتْ أَخْدَامَنَا. Firm our legs. وَانْصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ. فَهَزَمُوهُمْ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. They defeated them by the will of Allah. So Allah is al-mujib. The wife of Imran. Allahu alam, what is the name of the wife of Imran? She says, Rabbi, إني نذرت لك ما في بطني محررة فتقبل مني إنك أنت السميع العليم. فلما وضعتها قالت ربي إني وضعتها أنثى والله أعلم بما وضعت وليس الذكر كالأنثى وإني سميتها مريم وإني أعيذها بك وذريتها من الشيطان الرجيم. The wife of Imran. She's the mother of Maryam. So she asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala this dua. وَإِنِّي أُعِيدُهَا بِكَ وَذُرِّيَّتَهَا. Oh Allah, I seek refuge with you for her. From shaitan and her children. And Allah answered that. How? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, anyone, any new baby, the shaitan will touch him. Makes him to cry. Doctors mentioned that the baby cries because of what? To expand the lungs, because the lungs collapse. So immediately when he born, at the moment of giving birth, he cries, why? To open his lungs. Let the doctor say that.
This up to them. But in Sharia, why the baby is crying?
Because the shaitan
is stabbing him with his finger. Except Isa and his mother. Except Isa alayhi salam and his mother Maryam. They were not crying. Because of what? The dua of their mother. The mother of Maryam. Umm Maryam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered the dua of Maryam. The Surah Al-Kahf. Rabbana atina min ladunka rahma wa hayyi lana min amrina rashada. The people of the cave. Allah saved them. They make dua and Allah saved them. They went to inside the cave and Allah made them to sleep 300 years. Allah saved them from the disbelievers. So they invoked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So يعني the main thing here about the names Al-Qarib, Al-Mujib, to believe in that and to feel that and don't give up. Practice that by invoking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You should feel the support from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again and again and again, what is the problem of many Muslims? The lack of trust. We don't have this kind of trust. But imagine if you have the trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He is Al-Mujib. This is one of His names. To answer your call, to respond your dua. We are not calling Him. Or when we call Him, or when we invoke Him, without the trust. After the salah, you find many people. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum. Astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. Rabbana atina fid dunya hasanatan wa fil akhirati hasanatan. Allahumma ishfina, Allahumma afina. Go to your football, to your job, to whatever. Why we are making dua like this? Because I learned this from my parents. And my parents learned that from my grandparents. Khalas. It is a habit. We are saying a dua. We don't know the meaning of the dua. For many times, we don't know the meaning of the dua. Subhanallah. Maybe sometimes, Allahumma shfihi, give him the cure. Someone who's already died, and you ask for him the cure, because we are not focusing. This mind, not here. The heart, not here. It is there. It is not in Kuwait, outside Kuwait. Not with the salah. So, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, "Inna Allaha hayyun kareemun yastahi idha rafa' ar-rajul ilayhi yaday an yarudduhuma sifran khaibatayn." We mentioned this hadith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hayy, modest. Kareem, generous. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shy to reject the man who is raising his hands, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to retain his hands empty, sifran khaibatayn, which means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not leave you. If you are asking Him, invoking Him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will fill your hands with the answer. So the main thing in our topic today or in our lesson today is you invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and He will answer you because He is Al-Mujib, the answerer. وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ اِدْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. This is the equation. What is the equation? اِدْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. Invoke me, I answer you. So one of the scholars said, إِنِّي لَا أَحْمِلُ هَمَّ الْإِجَابَةِ وَلَكِنِّي أَحْمِلْ هَمَّ الدُّعَاءِ. How? He said, I'm not worried about the answer. I'm worried about the dua. They asked him, why? He said, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ اِدْعُونِي يَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. Invoke me, I answer you. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised something, for sure He will fulfill His promise. So now it is our duty to invoke Him. And it is not our duty to get the answer. It is the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah لا يخلف الميعاد. Allah doesn't break the promise. So where is the problem? The problem from our side, not from His side subhanahu wa ta'ala. For Him, the rules are there. He doesn't change His rules subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the answerer. He is near, not far. Subhanahu wa ta'ala.
جزاكم الله خير، صلي الله وسلم على نبينا محمد. Any question? Yes.
Can we name a person Mujib?
ما أدري والله، الله أعلم. Yes, yes, I know. They use the name Mujib. I don't know. شوف يعني if you check there is a nice book but it is in Arabic like this 600-700 pages. He mentions every name يعني the proof and at the end of every chapter he mentions who are the most famous people with this name. Yeah, for example if he mentions the name Ar-Rahman, so at the end of the chapter who is the most famous one with Abdurrahman, so for example he mentions Abdurrahman bin Auf. Okay, so you'll find some names, some names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not used by the scholars or the famous people to name. يعني for example, a scholar called Abd, يعني for example, Abd al-Hannan, maybe, just an example. Abd al-Mannan, yes, there is. Okay, so Abdul Mujib, I don't know. I need to check for that. Yes. Yes. Ibrahim alayhi salam. Ibrahim عليه الصلاة والسلام was making dua to protect, يعني, oh Allah protect my wife. Not is, should I send or not? Because he cannot reject. He was in a city of a tyrant person. They sent the soldiers, they took him, they took his wife. So the dua was, what we understand from the nation, the dua is to protect my wife. Oh Allah protect my wife. This is your question? Huh? What you can do? The situation of Ibrahim, it was like that. The situation of Ibrahim, it was like that. But the hadith doesn't... The hadith doesn't say you leave your wife without protection. Yes, in our Sharia, we have man mata, يعني if you die defending your wife, you are shaheed. If you die defending yourself, you are shaheed. If you die defending your wife, you are shaheed. But should I do that? I should not do that. It is not wajib. Because like the situation of Ibrahim alayhi salam, okay, he left. They took his wife and he was making dua. And maybe maybe there are soldiers catching him, he could not move. It doesn't, we should not understand that Ibrahim was happy to take his wife. A'udhu billah, for sure not. It doesn't mean that Ibrahim made it very simple for the tyrant king to take his wife. For sure it was not like that. Yes, the issue is for sure it was not easy. يعني it was not simple for Ibrahim. Okay, you like to take Allah. Allah Kareem, you take Allah. I will ask Allah. It was not like Abu Ta'ib, يعني Abdul Muttalib and Abraha. Okay, I don't care about the Kaaba. I care about my camels. For the Kaaba, there is a Lord can protect the Kaaba. For sure, we should not understand that from Ibrahim alayhi salam. But for our Sharia, yes, if you die defending your family, okay, you are shaheed. But it should not be in a crazy way. It should be in a wise way.
Can we make a specific dua and ask Allah to put khair in it?
To what?
To put khair in it. Like specific this job, Allah please grant this job and put khair in this job. Like is it okay to make dua like this?
Yes, make dua like this. يعني, and for example, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to work in this
school and oh Allah make the good for me in this school. You can't make. If you are not asking something haram, no problem. يعني شوف دعاء الاستخارة yes. In دعاء الاستخارة I'm asking Allah. Oh Allah if this is good for me so make it easy. And if it is not good for me then keep me away from it and keep it away from me. This is دعاء الاستخارة.
This one is opposite, like, it is not similar to istikhara, right? It is opposite, like you are thinking this job is good for you, so you make dua, oh Allah, grant this job for me and keep khairan.
Yes, yes, ma, no, no problem. Okay, يعني اللهم نسألك خيرا وخير ما جبلت عليه. If you buy, for example, a camel, if you buy a horse, okay, so you put your hand on that camel, that horse, and you ask, oh Allah, make it good for me. And I ask the good, and what is good it has. So I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, good, no problem, inshallah.
I think
dua
istikhara is the obvious way, right?
Sorry, dua istikhara, what?
The earlier stage than this.
Dua istikhara before the job. Tomorrow I will up I did the interview and I finished, then they told me tomorrow you come for signing the contract. So before going I pray two rak'ah and I make dua istikhara like that. جزاكم الله خير وصلي الله وسلم. Have dinner.
No, 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 no.